So good afternoon, everyone who's present here today. I am Harsha, Head of Communication and Thought Leadership at Tenon Group, and I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you on behalf of Tenon Group. Any gathering, virtual or physical, comes alive when you give the right start to it. And we are pleased to have 250 participants with us today as we commence the very first episode of our exclusive web series, Tenon Talks. Without delaying it any further, I would like to introduce our chairman, Major Manjeet Rajan, who perceived the whole idea of this talk series. Major Rajan founded Tenon Group in year 1995, and today, after 25 years of its establishment, the company stands tall as one of the leading integrated security and facility management company, having presence across India, UK, and Singapore. Let's hear it from Major Rajan. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Harsha. Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and it is my pleasure and genuinely my privilege to welcome all of you to this first edition of Tenon Talk series, which we have planned. The idea behind launching these exclusive series of webinars was to bring great minds of the industry together, thought leaders who could help us put our thoughts together to face this pandemic and put together the best practices which all of us could make use of. Over the past 3-4 months, I have attended a fair number of webinars. I'm sure all of you have also done. In fact, now, whenever I get invited to a webinar, my thought is what probably Karan Johar said in one of his introductions when he says, "Oh my God, one more remix." So I didn't want our webinar to be very similar. We wanted it totally to be focused on facility management and security put together, creating a safe and healthy workspace. We felt there was a vacuum in integrating these things that we and putting them in an actionable way for our customers, the outcomes that we come up with. This series intends to link one of the sessions to the next one and finally emerge with a comprehensive best practices package that we can share, use, and subscribe to. Today, security and facility management service providers who were earlier just perceived to be vendors have become most critical business partners and contributors to our safe and clean workspaces. This is evident from the incredible response that we have received in this seminar. And like Harsha said, we have today over 250 participants and we have nearly 500 registrations on it. I would like to really thank and welcome our very esteemed panel that we have the privilege of presenting to all of you. We have Colonel Harinder Bana, Associate Director, Global Security, PepsiCo. We have Ms. Asha Bhatania, ABP PVR Limited. We are expecting that Mr. Firoz Hussain would be joining us shortly. He's Chief of Security for Delivery. We also have Mr. Amit Mangla, Senior Vice President, Procurement and Facilities for Max Life Insurance. And last but not the least, Angad Rajan, the global IFM head for the Tenon Group and also our strategy head. We really value your presence here, and we have the privilege of having Ms. Mona, the editor of Clean India Journal, as the moderator, and I don't think we could have got a better moderator than that. I strongly feel that we are all in this situation together. We are all facing the same thing. The pandemic is pushing all of us to innovate, explore ideas, come up with solutions that can be deployed to face this critical problem. We have a challenge in security and facility management, which demands a new and a very different way of thinking. There is no doubt that our role is essential. It is the first line of defense, as I spoke somewhere day before yesterday, when any facility opens up. Our team at Tenon Group are in this sense really committed to joining forces with all of you with these actionable solutions that we come up with for everyone to feel safe, secure in their workplace. And I definitely look forward to hearing from you. We have tried to make this webinar a little different from most webinars. We probably are the first company in the industry to organize a knowledge-intensive series of webinars, which is totally dedicated to just integrated facility and security management. I'm sure you must have seen a whole lot of them about different topics, safe opening of workplace, et cetera, et cetera. But this is dedicated to integrated security and facility management. We are also focused and we are deliberating upon key considerations for the security and facility management industry and the leaders that shall keep the workplaces safe, trying to strike a perfect balance between resource utilization and employee safety, because they have to go hand in hand. Throughout this series, we will review the COVID-19 response for various sectors, how different business leaders have tried to handle it, the problems that they have faced, the shortcomings they have had, identify gray areas or gap areas, as we may call them, and collaborate in order to suggest a feasible solution. We are actually, as Tenon Group, also looking forward to gaining knowledge out of this. So we are not here to impart knowledge. We are here to discuss it with all of you and learn as much from you as we can share, as well as share what has been our experience. We will hope to offer relevant insights, pieces of advice to the industry, which all the professionals will come up with, on how to efficiently tackle this crisis, incorporating a preemptive policy. So we should not be behind the curve with procedures to create a safe and healthy work environment. I sincerely hope that this first series with this very august panel and this wonderful audience will be able to give us some ideas, solutions, thoughts, which can be put into ways which can be used practically by all of us. So I look forward to hearing from all of you. Once again, thank you very much to all of you who are attending this. Thank you very much to the panelists. And Ms. Mona, I hand over to you now. I think you're on mute, ma'am.
Mona, you are on mute.
You can hear me now?
Loud and clear.
Thank you so much, Colonel Manjit. And that was a wonderful introduction to the topic itself. And I should congratulate Tenon Talks and Tenon Group for this wonderful beginning. And it is a privilege that we all are here to create a chapter in Tenon's history. And I welcome all the panelists for this wonderful session and the launch of Tenon Talks as well. So not taking much time, as Colonel Manjit has already introduced the topic, Workplace 2.0, the emerging norms of integrated security and facility management. I would like to introduce the eminent panelist here today. We have with us Colonel Harendra Bana. He is the Associate Director, Global Security, PepsiCo India and South Asia. Having a rich experience of 32 years, Colonel Bana is a strong communicator with an ability to foresee, design, and deploy security plans to foster organization strength in order to promote business continuity. He possesses impeccable budget and time management skills. Aside to being a member of the PepsiCo Diversity and Inclusiveness team, he is a chairman of the OSAC Delhi chapter and of FICCI Homeland Security. He holds an ISO certification in both risk and business continuity management, and he's a member of the Fire and Security Association of India and a lifetime member of the United Service Institution of India, a Defense Services Security Think Tank Institute. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Let me introduce the lady on the panel, Ms. Asha Patania of the AVP Housekeeping PVR Limited. She is responsible for the national and international cinemas of PVR and leads a large team of 2,000 plus and over 100 million patrons annually. That's a great number, Asha. With a career spanning over two decades across various industries, including hospitality, real estate, and now multiplexes, she specializes in hotel reopening and renovation, housekeeping operations as well. As a highly qualified hotel management professional, she has worked with the key industry leaders and brands in hospitality, such as Holiday Inn, Country Inn Suites, Lemon Tree Hotel, Red Fox Hotels, and PVR Cinemas. And above all, she's a firm believer of right person for the right job, and her attitude counts more than skill. She's a huge fan of technology and training and believes in the power of collaboration and finding solution with long-term impact on business and positive growth. Welcome, Asha. And charming smile always, please.
Thank you, Mohana. That really made me sound very good about myself. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thanks a lot.
May I move on to Firoz Hussain? He is the Chief Security Officer of... Is he here already? Harsha?
Yes, he is.
Yes, Mohana.
Okay. He is the Chief Security Officer at Delhivery. Firoz is a forward-thinking and energetic industry leader currently engaged in e-commerce logistics with diverse experience of 30 years in security management, change management, quality leadership, and double-digit growth strategies. He has expertise in trafficking, investigation, drug enforcement, electronic surveillance, fraud and risk analytics, and financial frauds. Really, we have to be careful with him. As CSO at Delhivery, he oversees design implementation of preventative security standards, procedures and programs across the organization. He's the founder of the Totem SOS, a mobile app for women's safety. Thank you. I read this and I said I should thank you for bringing this out for us. Thank you very much, Mr. Firoz. And in addition to this, he is an alumnus of the IBLP International Visitors Leadership Program by the United States Department of State. A very warm welcome to you, Mr. Firoz. Mr. Firoz? I think you're
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Moving on, Mr. Amit Mangala. He's the Senior Vice President, Procurement and Facilities at Max Life Insurance with a career spanning across diversified industries like automotive, express logistics, technology services, and insurance. Amit has the experience of over 25 years, having contributed as both a practitioner and thought leader in the fields of industrial engineering, project management, corporate leader, real estate, and facilities management and sourcing. Amit is a part of the senior leadership team and leads CRE procurement and sales promotion at Max Life Insurance, which is India's most admired life insurance company and at number 24, the only one in the top 100 to have featured in Great Places at to Work ranking. Very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
And we have Angad Rajain. He needs no introduction, though I do the honors here. The global head of IFM and head strategy at Tenon Group, with an impressive corporate experience of more than a decade, impeccable leadership, and strong strategy orientation. Angad is responsible for overall strategy planning and execution in the organization across India and UK. Mainstreaming sustainability through technological advancements and creating stakeholder value through tactical growth and operations are his key focus areas. A very warm welcome to you too again, Angad. And
Thank
it's
you.
Such a pleasure. Actually, if we all look at the mix of the panelists here, I should say it's wonderful. You have the hospitality covered here. You have the insurance and the financial area covered here. You have the corporate sector covered here. In fact, there is no miss, and I should congratulate for putting in such a wonderful experienced panel together here. Not taking much time again, and I would remind those who have joined late, please ensure that you do the polling as well, because that's wonderful. As I started through the first question, I said no, I should go to the second, and even I did the polling there. It's nice, and you all should take that count as well. Okay, coming down to the initial questions for today, let's open it with the lady. Asha, this is for you.
Sure.
We are talking about hospitality and entertainment industry, which you have almost 2 decades experience here. So you probably know more well what is the consumer behavior, as you have closely experienced them all. Since both these sectors are largely impacted by the behavioral changes, especially due to COVID, what change of approach do you foresee will have to be adopted by the industry to bring back the confidence of the consumer and ensure better and safer end user experience? It sounds too complicated, but to be very frank, simple question. How will I be safe when I enter your PVR? Please tell me that. Simple.
Okay, so Mohana, thank you so much for that lovely introduction, and also giving me an opportunity to be the first panelist so I could actually thank Tenon and the entire team. Major Rajin, Brigadier Oberoi, Angad, and everyone that I'm associated with, and Mohana, you, for having this opportunity. And like you rightly mentioned, that the panelist is actually, this is a spook when you do that. In a movie parlance, you say, you know, the casting is fabulous. So this is what I say, the first series of Tenant Talks. And I think it's a great coup that Tenant has been able to pull to be able to get so many people representing such various experiences. Having said that, Mohana, to answer your question, this was part of the survey also. And I actually went without blinking to say I would like to go to the cinema first. So I'm being selfish. And of course, I want everyone at this survey also to feel that confident. Things are not normal anymore. And the changing life as we know it, a new normal is coming out. It's no more the way we used to live, and all of us can see the change. It's happening right now all around us, and the way we used to think and take our work and life for granted. And you can say surely that a threat of a contagion has actually twisted the way, you know, the psychological response to ordinary interactions were happening. And people are some people are really going overboard with it, and some are not doing enough. And the fear seems to be traveling faster than the corona. So, you know, there are two ways. How much should you do? How much is enough? And are we going to overdo something and create a panic which is not needed? So coming to the questions that you asked, it's a very relevant question for our industry. When I say our industry, I see hospitality, tourism, restaurant, cinemas. Because we have always been considered as the luxury. We have never been considered as essentials. It's a different matter that, you know, these industries do employ a lot of people. And a lot of people earn their earnings from these industries. And integrated facility and hospitality, multiplexes, malls, everybody has been severely impacted. It becomes the onus of the client and the agency or the service provider, in our case, we could say, the onus purely lies in us. One is that how do we plan for it? More than that, how do these organizations, these industries are able to communicate to it? Why would Mohana would come to a mall? Why would she leave the surroundings which she feels safe in? Why would he even want to step out? What should a hotel, hospital, mall, or a multiplex chain should do to give you that confidence? So these are there's a lot which has been done, which needs to be done. And I have to compliment a lot of people that I know, the housekeepers and the facility agencies who have come together and taken this burden. A lot of compliments could go to the government agencies. So in a planned way, how do I see it that the confidence building could happen is we have to change the scenario, how people think about going to these places. So there's a lot of fear which is going that if you go to X place and you, you know, it's now getting airborne. So every day a new information is coming. Every day a new challenge of handling it is coming. First and foremost, for any organization, we could be a multiplex or a mall or a hotel, is that you have to keep yourself updated on the changing scenario. What is happening around you? You need to be constantly updating yourself. What was relevant 10 days back is not relevant anymore. So what we have done to keep ourselves totally, maybe what Major Rajan said, that don't be behind the curve. You've got to be ahead of the curve, anticipate. So one is that we are already hearing a lot of it. A lot is happening. Through technology, you could find out what is happening around the world. There are some businesses which are already opening. So try to learn from them. What is it that they are doing? Airports, hospitals, the businesses outside India. What they did good, what did not work for them. So the examples are happening around us. We could not limit ourselves to only my business, my way of working, my agency. You have to open up. It wasn't necessarily earlier. It has become mandatory. You would perish if you were to not compare and share notes with each other. There should be absolutely no competition or a one-man upship in terms of safety of your customers. When I say customers, it's both internal and external. So we have our employees who are totally depending on us. And then there are, of course, the patrons, customers, guests, as you call them, who would come to us if they feel and they have the trust in your brand to say, I would be here and I would not carry back anything from here, which could lead any way or have an adverse effect on my health and safety. So those physical distancing markers, those sanitizers, those personal prevention equipments, the PPE kits. There are so many things happening around us, but there are also a lot of fake stuff happening. So my advice for people who are listening to this webinar is that there's a lot which is happening around us. Some of it is relevant to us. Some of it is not. So you need to sift through it, pick up what is important for your business, what is logistically possible for your business. You cannot blindly follow something which does not work for you, is not needed for you because X is doing it. And of course, invest in a lot of technology. This is the time to really push for that budget where you say the contactless digital ways of doing things. The physical interaction has to come to the minimum without taking away the human factor. At no point are we saying, let's get away with the humans, which make a very important social environment for us. We want our people there, but we want everybody safe at a safer distance. And technology has been a huge savior for us. And the need of adopting it is now more than ever needed and required. Another thing that I feel is that you tie up with experts. No harm for asking for help when you get a doctor on board or you get a health specialist on board who comes and checks your employees. And of course, there's a need for isolation rooms that everybody is now talking and it is there as part of the guidelines. Health checkups should be mandatory. We cannot leave it for our staff to invest that kind of money in their medical health checkup. All the PPEs have to be provided to the employees. There's a lot of awareness which needs to be passed on. Once you update yourself, you have to remove the fear. Remove the fear. Teach them it is nothing but a virus. And as long as you maintain safe distance, as long as you wash your hands, as long as you are keeping hygiene spaces, everybody is going to be safe. If at all, God forbid, somebody was to contract it, just an isolation should take care of it. Very few people actually need to go to the hospital. So allay that fear that if I was to contract one, I'm going to be over with my life. That's not happening. Also, for the patrons, every industry, they need to now start anticipating, listen more to what their customers expect from them. So like the survey that we did here, I think every industry could do that. We have already done one. And 75% of our regular patrons said they wanted to come back. And there were a few things that they wanted. Of course, they wanted clean spaces. They wanted people serving them who were healthy, who should be wearing the right PPE kits. And the food has to be handled well. The journey has to be mapped and made safe in every possible way. So listening to your people through a mode of survey, through emailers, or asking them directly would go a long way in building that confidence to say, we are listening to you. What is your fear? And what am I going to do to take care of that part? That's there. Then, of course, you have to keep your SOPs, your standards now going to the next level. The cleaning was there. The hygiene was there. Now we are talking about sanitation. We are talking about sterilization. We cannot leave it only looking clean. It has what you can't see has become more important. The trend used to be what I could see could become the trend. I look clean, but am I really clean? So there should be some kind of a benchmarking. There should be some way for me to be able to gauge it, to calculate it, to be able to present it to my customers to say, listen, I am clean. And here I have this certificate or I have this report to share with you, which certifies to say, yes, my place is totally, absolutely clean. So, you know, some kind of a benchmarking and some form of certification will certainly help to say that it will happen. Then, of course, when a patron comes to your premises, seeing is believing. So I could always be the most sanitized and sterilized place. But what am I doing to give that confidence to my employee, to my patrons, to anyone who wants to come to my area and space, is we do everything as they expect us to do. The courteousness becomes more important. We cannot panic them. We should not look like hospitals. We have to make sure that we do not trigger any wrong emotions in people. They have stepped out to get that different feeling. The excellence of our service should take first. Our smiles should be there from our eyes, because obviously our faces are by and large covered with masks nowadays. So you smile, you do that namaskar, you do gestures to, you bow down and you say, I look forward to welcoming you. I look forward to serve you. And every journey of the employee, every journey of the guest should be mapped. What all touch points areas they would come in contact with. There should be checklists associated with it. They have to clean it. The checklist should be on display. People should be visibly cleaning it. Certified, invest in certified medical grade in, disinfectant. You could tie up with leading hospital chains, and you give that confidence to people to say, my place is ready for you. My premises are safer for you. And there should be not enough emphasis can be done on updating the knowledge, on training of employees, a small dry run of doing stuff, because things look very easy. Change is the biggest thing that a human mind resists. Nobody likes a change. The biggest challenge, I feel, that there could be irate customers who do not follow the given protocol. The employees who feel that what they can't see, there should be no fear. So a little bit of a fear, which comes through education, training, awareness, posters, mailers, has to happen. And of course, the security checks would be there. I think that would be taken care by our other panelists who are good at it. I personally feel that if people were to think like this, when the right time happens and the lockdowns are lifted, I think organizations, if they were to invest in like this, plan it properly, run a dry run, see what works for them, what is needed for them, get their manforce ready without any fear, I think we all would be very good to go, Mona.
Thank you so much, Asha. That was so beautifully curated and, you know, put all points covered here. And I will congratulate, I have got information that you have all the multiplexes who have joined hands and put in some very new technology. In fact, these new technologies have been put by the service providers, I hear. Which actually ensures that any surface you touch is not going to infect you, because they are so hygienically protected with the new yes. technologies. And congratulate, I think it's something called electrostatic technology, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, Mohana, and we are investing big time in that technology to keep our surfaces absolutely clean. And there's a certificate, which I said, a customer and an employee, the confidence comes from showing somebody from an expert body. So right. that's the next step we have done.
Great. Thank you so much, Asha. And yes, like she says, that it is necessary that we build the confidence in the people around us. It also is like fighting a war. I wouldn't say no, it is a pandemic war, and each one of us are putting it in a different role. And calling forward Colonel Harendra Bana, who has been in the army, and I'm sure he's fought or seen many wars. So how is he facing this war? Let us hear from him. Bana Saab, what were the dynamic challenges this situation presented to you, your domain, and what are the innovative solutions we can look at towards an integrated security management approach in corporate security to manage a crisis of this magnitude?
Bana Saab. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And you know, you just mentioned about war, but then, you know, after 33 years, which are 20 years in the army and 13 years in the corporate, you know, and having been chairman for OSAC Delhi for the last 5 years, you know, I actually started feeling like Dharmender, that he can do everything, nothing can go wrong, and the He-Man, And I tell a friend of mine, actually in this COVID scenario, made me realize that I wasn't Dharmender at all. I maybe have been Jitender. So I'll give you the story. She called me up one day and she said, sir, I need some help. And she's a dear friend. And I said, yes, of course. So she said, I wanted to open adult creche for the children. I said, adult creche? I've never heard of this. She said, you have heard of creche? Creche is for the younger children. But with the COVID hitting us and I need to be working and I need my timelines, my children just don't stay in my control. I need OZAC to help me open adult creche where I can put my kids there.
Oh my
God. I said,
God.
Interesting. Interesting. Then I really looked at her and I said, I'll try and do something for it. It's been 2 months, but I then haven't done anything on it. I realized how incapable I am on this. But then I also asked her, but you have your hubby also at home in the lockdown. She says, it's the kids which bother me. The hubby, I can just stare at him. He sits in one corner. The children are a problem for me. Mm-hmm. So having said that, let's move on to where the COVID is and the two nice things about COVID. Everybody across the world gloom and everybody saying that it's bad. But two things really have helped us is it's taught us how to wash our hands. Trust me, not many of us knew how to wash our hands. I myself would go in, it was just a few seconds. And the second thing is the nice thing about COVID is there's no bias. Developing, underdeveloped, fully developed country, rich, poor, everybody has been equally impacted. So you have no, you can't have any complaints. Ki usko kyun hua, mujhe kyun nahi hua. In time, everybody will get it. So have your patience, we'll all get our turns. So that's the nice part. Now let's move on to the corporate security. And that's extremely, extremely interesting. The first thing that I'd like to say is, look at collaboration today. That's the key word over here. And it's a great fancy word. It's been there in Harvard Business Journal for many years. People have heard of it. Let's collaborate. But trust me, if I were to corporate security were to collaborate with facility, we were cousins in the same company, we would not look eye to eye with each other. We would always be competing with each other. This facility guy would say, Asha's team is not fine. Or she would say the corporate security is not fine. It was a tug of war. And then there was a third cousin who also wanted to enter the door. He said, "Main bhi ghus jata hun bhai." So he was EHS, Environmental Health and Safety. So all three of us were at a tangent, all three of us not listening to each other. But this is one big story which COVID brought us. It brought us to the same table. It made us understand that how the power of collaboration works. And whether I liked it or not, today my teams, my corporate security colleagues in the industry knew that we had to collaborate with our peers in the facility team, sit with them, talk to them, understand with them their challenges and work together to a solution mutually. And that's the time when EHS also came in as the third invisible brother. And then we realized that the three of us can be a very, very potent team to help us keep our employees safe, keep our assets safe, and to ensure that we remain alive. That's the most important thing. That was missing link as far as the collaboration went. The second most important thing which I realized was cross-functional. It's a nice fancy word again, cross-functional. I'll give you the simpler word for it, which my wife doesn't like, is multitasking. So she says you can't multitask, she says if you multitask, you're not doing anything. So I don't know, but it was multitasking. It was an emergency at a national and a global level. Why did we reach into this cross-functional job where it was also called multifunction was because moment the migrant crisis started, people started going back home. There was a dearth of manpower. There was a human crisis and what was a security man's job was also looking at a facility man. Because he was collaborating, he did not feel shy of doing a cross-functional job. And if Asha's team would ask somebody that I'm short of manpower, can the security help us? The team would automatically step in to fill in the gaps. And people were not just doing security, they were also doing facility jobs. It was a very, very rare gesture that came out spontaneously amongst people because they realized that if the facility man got the COVID, they would also get it too. So it was in their interest to keep the other man safe, to keep themselves safe. It was a very, very unique situation. It has never happened. And the important thing was each one of us was looking at the safety of the other person to keep himself safe. That's the second point I want to bring out. So we have two C's, a collaboration and we have a cross-functional. The third thing which I want to raise over here is preparedness. Every company had a BCP plan. And I don't know if a single company can come forward. I know there are 7% companies which have come forward to say that they had predicted this. I wish them well. I don't think how deep they could have predicted it. It's only their ROIs which will give us the true understanding. But then preparedness was a paper document for most of us. We would tick it off. We would sign it off. We would do an annual check. And in the military, you have to do an annual security certification. Like most corporates do an info security check and they need everybody to go through it. So having done 13 years in the corporate or maybe 6 years in my company, I know the questions, I know the answers. They're by heart, we would tick mark them. But this is one situation where our preparedness was challenged. And it was challenged, when does the true potential of your preparedness get tested? When you're trying to keep the colleague who's with you, who's your battle buddy, who's been in the office with you, to keep them safe. We were praying that I don't mind if I get COVID, but I would be very unhappy if the person sitting next to me or within my office got COVID because the security or the facility team failed somewhere. And the BCP plans, each one of us, when we look back at our BCP plans somewhere, we needed to learn from each other. Trust me, it was for the first time that people used a WhatsApp group for a social purpose, for a common goal, and for a learning opportunity. Otherwise, in the past, there were only short jokes and messages floating around. But here, people were not scared to ask the questions which were required from each one of us on how were you doing things better? How could you improve things? And it was a fantastic learning opportunity for each of us to come together, come prepare ourselves, and to ensure that we are safe, the next man is safe, and our colleagues are safe. The last but not the least, that's a very important point I want to touch upon over here, investment in training and empowerment. Both the things were missing. I don't say for any one particular company, whether it is one service provider, but we would all pay for trainings, we would all give our margins and whatever it was a document and they would invest a certain amount on the trainings of the people. But importantly, the exponential increase in the number of trainings and the effort put in by all the guarding agencies and the private security industry as such to ensure that all people, all their clients, and every single person is safe, he goes back safe, he remains healthy, was phenomenal. When we can say that maybe earlier the preparedness or the investment on training may not have been, the guard was sleeping or he was not doing, but this was a situation where even if we failed, even if we were not scared to fail, but we were more conscious that we got to get up each day and do a better job. The amount the private security industry has invested in training at this point is absolutely commendable. They have helped us keep ourselves safe. And besides the Indian Army and a lot of other large organizations like the Indian Railways, which are large employee base, private security industry collectively is also as huge as some of the largest in the country. And let me make a very important point here that a lot of clients and a lot of companies have gone back to the security industries and the private security service providers to say that we don't have our employees coming to office or we don't have enough work, so reduce our service margins and do not take. But the most awesome initiative has been, while they agreed to reduce it at some point, at some numbers, X, Y, whatever it was, they reduced the service charges. The service element in terms of keeping people healthy, delivering technological support to ensure that their guards, the people, the employees remain safe, did not go down by 1% also. It's an absolute awesome initiative, a huge contribution to the National Health Index, and it's been amazing, absolutely. To summarize, let's look back, and we must continue to collaborate. That's the new keyword. In the past, integrated facility management, security management have always failed because we were looking at our own individual goals. We were not sitting together. This is a great opportunity where we have got together. Let's move on and use the collaboration together. Cross-functional, let's continue to improve the skill sets of our people, not just towards knowing just a security job, but he should know maybe somebody else's job also. And that will be a phenomenal step up towards enhancing the skill set of the workforce. Preparedness, it's a daily affair now. It's not that today we would do it. Trust me, what India has experienced in the last couple of months, no other country has done it. We've had earthquakes, we have cyclones, we have locust attacks, and we've had everything that one can think of, including some border issues. So we have challenged ourselves to the extreme. Let's keep ourselves prepared. And last but not the least, let us continue to invest in training. Let us support the private security industry to ensure that they can keep their people healthy to keep us healthy. Thank you so much. It's been wonderful speaking. Thank you, Tanon, for giving me this opportunity. Warm regards.
Thank you so much. And firstly, I should give applause to all the people who are engaged in the security for helping us or everybody through this time. I think they require applause for this. And thank you for the guiding force of leaders like you, Colonel Bana, for making it possible, because they also need the confidence of doing such a wonderful job that they are doing at present in the COVID situation. Now, talking of the security forces, yes, when we talk as individual, yes, I have insured myself. But has everybody insured themselves? Is the security guy insured? Is his life? Is his everything insured? Is a big question. So moving on to the insurance background we have with Mr. Amit Mangala, this question comes to you. Is we are talking about at one end where our country is witnessing mass momentum in work from home situation. And some of us, it is a big challenge. And of course, it's for you also, I'm sure. But since insurance is a behavior-driven purchase and needs personalization, what challenges do work from home concept bring forth for your sector, especially the insurance? Unless the insurer comes and speaks to me, I'm definitely not going to take one. And how have you worked to make it safer for your employees while bringing them back to work? Mr. Amit Mangala.
Thanks a lot, Mona. So, in the whole process, what we witnessed over last 3 odd months, there were many learnings for us also as insurance industry, Mona. And some of the mindset, some of the myths which we had in mind as far as our industry is concerned, they were also, sort of corrected to a large extent. But let me come to that later. Yes, you're right. Max Life is a large insurer. It is, currently number 3rd as far as private life insurance sector is concerned. And, it might be number 3rd as far as size is concerned. But as far as customer centricity, as far as, employee is concerned, I think we try to be right up there. You mentioned in my introduction also, this year we have scored 24th rank amongst all, companies in India. And that is something which we really take pride on, because none of our peers, rivals in financial services sector, are even in top 100. Because that is something which is in this, sector is not considered to be a kosher. this sector is generally considered with selling, lot of selling. And as you mentioned, you know, push-based selling. Insurance has always been, considered as a product which is sold, which is not bought. It is always solicited. And that's how the employees and other stakeholders, they take a back seat compared to, the selling proposition. Now, when we were faced with this situation in the middle of March, one of the things which we said that time was that, we really have a choice as a company between ensuring the safety, wellness of our employees, and to recoup the business, to salvage the business as far as possible. So that was the choice we were faced with. And like many other corporates of our size and standing, we immediately started to, close down the offices. And we said that, whoever wants to work from home, they can start doing that. And of course, the reaction was, quite predictable. Most of the guys, they started work from home, and literally, everybody. That despite of the fact that we were always in the essential services category. So apart from banking, insurance is another industry which was always allowed by government, even in lockdown period, to open the office, at least to service the customers. And that is how we started facing the dilemma. When we closed the offices, we found that our competitors, and the bigger competitors also, they started opening their offices even during the lockdown, and with a much larger workforce, as and when the lockdown started getting thinning out. And here were we, which we said that, nothing doing, do your work from home. We won't open the office because we want you to be safe. The other thing, which our CEO, said early on as a vision, and it was quite some statement, we are an organization which are today more than 15,000 plus employees strong, and other 40 to 50,000 other associate partners like agents and all who help us in selling the products. Our CEO said that my vision is that I don't want any of my employees, getting affected by COVID, and least of all, even if that unfortunate situation happens, I don't want any casualty, and I don't want any of them to come to office just because they are under any pressure of selling or anything, and they catch COVID because of coming to office. So that was his reason. And on the other hand, the dilemma was that how do you face your competitors who were opening the offices, who were selling the policies. And our sales guys also were under tremendous pressure. So that is how this whole thing started. And when the lockdown was removed, and then we were in lockdown two, and then we deliberated that can we at least start opening the offices to the extent where our guys can come and service the customers, if not selling. One who is walking into the office, how can that person be served? Because at the end of the day, people need servicing. Somebody would need the policy. Someone has expired in someone's family, and they would need to file the claim. And if it can't be done online, then the person will come to office. So how do we enable that? So there were various regulations going all around. We are present in almost 200 plus cities with 300 70 odd offices. And the regulations were changing quite fast. There were MHA guidelines, there were different state guidelines, there were district guidelines early on, and these regulations were also changing every week actually. So amongst this issue, the biggest challenge which we faced was as a team, as a department, that we were never equipped to handle such a situation, because having such a large geographical presence and not anticipating such a scenario can befall on us. There was not a single person in my team who was present in any of these offices. Facilities for us, real estate for us was always meant to open the offices, meant to finalize the specifications of an office, do the rental negotiation with landlords, sign the contract with them. Never really making sure that the office is working fine, because the offices are not of that large size. They might be 2,000 square feet, 5,000 square feet. And it's the office guys who will manage it. We will, you know, provide them basic, cleaning services, security services and all. So how do you ensure that, you know, these offices, when they are open, our employees are safe and only the right persons go inside it without having your, feet on the ground there? And that's when, you know, we put our heads together and we said that, you know, let's use both technology as well as, you know, human resources. Because, you know, one without the other would be incomplete in this scenario. We don't have great technology with us to handle this situation, as well as there are no people around to handle it. And that's when, you know, Mohana, some of the innovative things, you know, started coming in mind. So as far as human efforts was concerned, what we did was, we had some people in our team who were actually, you know, not really capable of doing any work from home. And these were largely contractual staff. As a company, we employ lots of contractual staff also to do, you know, the work which are not so value added. Like, for example, the front office, guy. That person can't do anything from office. But as a company, we also took decision that we will not fire anyone. We will not reduce the wages of any person, whether it is a full-time employee or whether it is a vendor staff. So, you know, 15 days, 30 days on into the lockdown, and how do we, make use of these resources? So in my team and in some other teams, I pulled, 15 or 16 of these resources. And I said that, guys, look, this is an opportunity and a challenge for all of us. We are faced with such a situation. So let's do one thing. When we start opening the offices, 15 days before opening any office, there is this questionnaire of, 15 questions. You will telephonically call up, every day, the guard of that office, and you will call the operations executive who is there to serve the customer every day. And you will ask that person some basic questions. Questions like, whether the office has been sanitized completely, whether there are, thermal scanners available, whether there are masks available, whether, the ACs and all, equipments have been serviced well because the office has been closed for quite some time. And over a period of 15 days, once we have enough data points for each office, then we will open that office. So that is how, we started opening our offices. And unlike many of our peers and competitors, the facilities or the real estate team really, in those companies have not managed this process. They have left it to the office leadership, the office staff to do it. So they have provided the essentials like masks and sanitizers, etc. But at the end of the day, it is the office staff who is responsible for maintaining the hygiene and the regulations. Whereas in our case, we said, no, it should be a centralized thing because we are not looking at complying only with the MHE guidelines. Tomorrow, if there is an audit, if there is any inspection, there should be one neck to, role. We can't be looking at 370 guys to do that. And second, how do we maintain a standardized level of service across all our offices? So this was, something we did. And similar thing we did when we opened the office. So a similar set of, questions, bit tweaked questions, 10 to 15 of them, where again, these guys were called daily and asked some questions, whether the office has been working fine, whether you are maintaining the temperature of the air conditioning, stuff like that, whether there is any shortage of sanitizers. So through this basic human, thing, we started, opening the offices and gave comfort to our employees that when you enter the office and when you work inside the offices, you are safe. The second thing, which we did, and we realized that only the human intervention can't work in such a scenario because there might be tendency that someone who's calling from my end might have a tendency to fudge the data, or someone who's answering the question might not be, doing it correctly. Okay. And then there is fatigue factor also for how long you can, ask the same question daily and how long you can answer them daily. And that's where technology also, came into play, Mona. We, early on as an organization, we invested in digital a lot. That might be one of the, the reasons might be that, we ourselves as an industry are very digital in nature. And some of those practices we implemented here. So I will give you an example. Ran a project called Look and Feel, 1 year back. And that project, what it did was, around 60 checkpoints, for each office. And that is where, our thing of integrated facility management also comes into play. And I wanted to touch upon that thing. But how is that where integrated facility management has helped us? because, you know, my lens was very clear that for me, security and housekeeping are not different things. From the day I have assumed this role, for me, you know, they were both same thing. And when I say both, actually, it is not only both also, it is multitude of things. For me, it is really the philosophy. And the philosophy is that my facility should be with one person. And that person should be managing everything which is not related to my business. If it comes to insurance, then we are experts. If it is not insurance, then it is my service provider who is managing my facility. And that person should be doing pretty much everything unless there is a capability issue on certain technical things. Okay. Now, you know, in this look and feel project, for example, coming back to it, you know, there was a 60-point checklist which we implemented 1 year back, where all the offices were audited on this, you know, checkpoint. And they were, you know, over the period of next 1 year, all of them were brought to a same level. So first of all, you know, these were audited. They were rated on, you know, on the ranking scale. There were deficiencies which were written down. And then each office was invested a certain amount to bring them at par. So if you go to any Max Life office today, you will find that, you know, obviously there can be difference in layout, there can be difference in some sort of look and feel, because these are not owned properties, these are all leased properties. And depending on the business, you have different sized offices. But as far as amenities are concerned, as far as hygiene is concerned, as far as, you know, facilities are concerned, they will all look similar to you. So we did that over, you know, last 1 year. That helped us a lot when we resumed the offices, because structurally, fundamentally, these offices were capable, you know, already. There was no inherent deficiency in them. The second thing which we did was, you know, we started a caretaker model. It is still in pilot, but we plan to do it big time. And that caretaker model was simple. For our smaller sized offices, we said that there will be only one person. No security, no housekeeping. One person who is custodian of the full office. That person, you know, will do the security guard job whenever it is required. And whenever there is time, you know, that person will do the janitorial job, because there would be very few people in that office. Most of the guys will be out for sales. And, you know, essentially that person will be my eyes and ears. There will be no passing on the buck between security, housekeeping, operations, this. The third thing which we, you know, did was, and, you know, that is still under processes, because, you know, we did not have any feet on the ground in each office. And, you know, the unfortunate thing with some of the facilities functions is that, you know, there is a little C-level visibility. And thus, you know, the remit to get those sort of resourcing is a bit difficult than what the business gets. So we said that instead of, you know, crying horse about not having resources on the field, and there are 370 of them, can we manage it a bit smartly? So the way we have zonal facility managers, and I have four of them in four zones of India, we have made our security guard as office facility manager. And, you know, we have done it in a very simple way. So there is an app which we have got developed. That app, you know, enables that guard to come to office half an hour daily in the morning, half an hour early in the morning, sorry. And that person will fill that checklist. It's a simple 10-point checklist where it says that, you know, is my machinery working in the office? Are my ACs working? Has the office been, you know, sanitized properly, cleaned properly? And then, you know, once he submits the form, it will go to the respective zonal facility manager who will take whatever action is required at his end. If he is not capable of doing that, then he will send the same thing over the app to my head office in Gurgaon. And the person sitting there would then, you know, handle it appropriately. So instead of, you know, relying on the office staff to do that and do it at a much later stage, we said that we will do it daily. And we will do it through guard, because, you know, I don't have any other resources. That guard, you know, can pretty well do it for us. So we have started empowering those, you know, those guys. And they also, you know, feel much more motivated that my job is not only to guard a post, but I am also, you know, now responsible for making sure that my office is working, you know, in a right way. And, you know, over time, we will attach rewards and recognition program to it also. One of the important things is we invested in IoT, like a concept, not a full-blown IoT, but a similar thing. Each of my office, for example, Mohana, and, you know, this is not there anywhere in the industry, including banks. Each of my office today is connected live with 8 to 10 CCTV cameras, which are sensor controlled. Okay. So, you know, although when we did this, the intention was not, you know, COVID or something. The intention was that if there is any breakage in the office during night, because we don't have night security in our offices, then through that sensors, we should be knowing, you know, what's happening inside the office. There is a panic button mechanism, like an SOS button, pretty much similar thing like, you know, the way Uber and Ola does. If any office needs any support from head office, then that person has to simply press that button. And we have, you know, all the contacts of that office mapped with us, including police, fire, you know, ambulance, everything is mapped with us. As soon as, you know, that thing comes to us, you know, the person at command center gets into motion. And, you know, these resources are then activated to take immediate steps. At times, there are problem of irate customers. You know, insurance is a business where, you know, every day there are such instances where people will come, shout, they will get very angry. They will at times resort to, you know, physical violence also. And that is the time when, you know, the office needs help. You know, that office might be somewhere in a remote location in Bihar. And that office head might not be knowing what right action to take. He's not, you know, trained enough to do that. He's a sales guy. But my guy, you know, sitting here in head office, who's a security person, he is well equipped to, you know, talk to that customer and, you know, settle the situation amicably. So that is, you know, another thing which we did. And of course, you know, we invested very heavily in organizing emergency drills for all our offices. This is something which happens in very few corporate offices. But it doesn't happen in very small format offices, because most of these offices are multi-tenanted, where you don't have proper infrastructure, where you don't have place to train the people, where you can't show them the demo of fire extinguisher. But, you know, we did all of that, and we have been doing that over the last 2 years. And we have trained our office staff in such a way that, you know, in each of my office, at least 2 to 3 guys are now well trained on handling any emergency, whether it is earthquake, whether it is fire, you know, these things, you know, everyone is well trained on. And this is all done in-house by my own security team. So these were some of the steps which we took, you know, in the last 3-4 years, which paid us rich dividends when COVID happened. Now look, CCTV, for example, you know, CCTV helps me today in randomly, you know, checking and auditing whether social distancing is being maintained in those offices. Otherwise, how would I check 370 odd offices? Okay, whether, you know, there are enough sanitizers at the front desk or not, whether people are, you know, putting on the masks or not. So this is something which we never anticipated, but which is, you know, giving us rich dividends today. Similarly, you know, look and feel. Similarly, you know, emergency drills. These are the things which, you know, technology helped us. Some of it unintentional, but, you know, it was a byproduct. You, as they say, you know, it never, you know, fails you if you invest in the right thing. So this is what happened to us also as far as technology is concerned. And you know, to that extent, I would say that this is how, you know, we are making our offices more safe for our people. You know, other thing which I would also like to mention in technology is we developed an in-house employee app. We already have an employee app with us. What we did was we created a workflow in that. Mm-hmm. And any employee which has to come to office has to necessarily go to that app and submit a form. And that form asks some basic questions like, you know, whether, you know, you are showing any symptoms, whether you had any fever in last 13, 14 days and blah, blah. Similar, you know, something. Whether in your family you have anyone who's, you know, who's showing symptoms. That workflow, you know, goes to approval to his manager. And once the manager approves it, then, you know, that will go to facility, and then only that person will be allowed after showing the app and all. So this is how, you know, we have made, So this is how, you know, these things we took, you know, over time, Mona, and these have, you know, really paid us rich dividends. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations. I think you have put a lot of remote control practices into place, and that's actually showing the success of how we are going about it. Not missing out a point that we are also live on Facebook. I request all the attendees here to please post your questions in the chat, because we have a couple of more speakers before we take on the questions. Coming to Mr. Feroz Hussain, we were just talking about how you can work remotely, but there is one sector, that is logistics, which cannot and has to be on the field. So I'm sure there are hundreds of challenges that you're facing here, especially when you're talking about in your industry where change management, how did you build this resilience in the business to ensure that the lifeline of the country does not get affected or hampered with the increased workload along with the higher safety requirements, especially at this times when you have to be on the field?
Thank you very much, Mohana. It has been a very challenging time. I think the last few months we've passed through, luckily, the bad phase, and now it's more of the unlock phase which is going on. I think I must firstly thank Tenon because of the double benefit which we had. Because the moment the lockdown happened, you know, we had 40,000 employees, we had 3,200 warehouses, and many of the warehouses are having hundreds of crores of goods, whether it's from the ACs or the phones or TVs and things like that. So the good part is that we were able to, the guards and the security team, you see, in a crisis response, it's the first response always comes from the security, because the rest of the crowd gets sort of, bolted out of the blue. And so this was the time what we did is with the help of the guards, and we also had the Tenon housekeeping people. So we managed to get the sanitization done for all the facilities, get the masks, get the sanitizers, things like that in place, and be able to sort of start the warehouses. We, of course, had the problem because the first 2 days just after the lockdown, almost nothing was moving. So this was a time which required a lot of close coordination with all the government agencies, the police organizations, to understand the different notifications and be able to comply with them. So since we had the advantage of automatic sorting machines, so we were then able to, because only essential goods could be transported across for the first few days, the government basically came to us that we have a basic need of being able to supply medicines, masks, sanitizers, hospital equipment to the various hospitals and the government institutions and the private citizens across the country. And they realized that unless they engage with the large companies who are into logistics, that will really not be possible. So this was the first time where where I would say even officers of very senior rank, whether it's in the police, whether it's IGP or the superintendents of police of various districts, even many secretaries in the government, this was the first time when they were all available on WhatsApp and on WhatsApp groups. And they were trying to, because even many of them could not go to the offices. So many of the notifications, many of the orders could not get published. So they were trying to be able to coordinate all this. And I must appreciate the way the government has taken forward this particular COVID methodology of dealing with it, whereby they adopted a method of working with the private sector. Probably this is the first time where the government has worked so closely with the private sector to ensure that the supply chain does not get stopped. So initially, it was only the supply chain of the masks, medicines, and things like that, hospital equipment. The next phase was, of course, food and essential supplies. There's a lot of food, whatever, and food grains and things like that. Now, you suddenly have a situation, when the COVID was announced, you have like 3,000 warehouses which are running, you have a couple of thousand trucks on the road, and about 40,000 people who are going to their offices, and suddenly they all stopped at home because they cannot come out. Now, suddenly, if you have to be able to motivate such a large team of people in midst of a COVID scenario, the way we went forward is we started with the Facebook live sessions with all the employees across Pan India, so that we would be able to understand what they are feeling, and we would be able to communicate to them that this is something like a national work which we are doing, a nationalistic work, which was something which was later coined like COVID warrior and things like that. So what we said is that each of you are the COVID warriors, and each of you, if you're going to deliver those medicines to whichever parts of the country, that's the kind of service that you'll be giving, and the country will remember, the people will remember. So I think that's where that's how the beginning started. We of course did a lot of work also on contactless, whether it is contactless payments, contactless delivery. The other problem, of course, was in the large warehouses where you have a couple of hundred people working, and you have a lot of hotspots where the high viral load transmission can happen. Things like water dispenser. You see, everybody in the hot season, everybody has a need of water. Everybody, since we'll be talking about washing hands, everybody has to go to the soap dispenser, and they're using pressing a button and then dispensing soap. So that's when we said that, okay, we've got to change everything to contactless. So there's contactless soap dispensers, contactless sanitizer dispensers, and things like that. So that's how we were able to sort of really control the spread. Otherwise, the person-to-person spread does happen. We all know about, the COVID thing. The other was we gave all the warehouses right in the beginning. Luckily, since we were already into logistics and we got we were sort of prepared, I would say, to a certain extent, because we already had started work from home, and since we had sufficient stocks of of masks, sanitizers, and things like that, so we could deploy them across the country. We were one of the first to give oximeters to all the 3,000 warehouses, so that people, if somebody is not well, he can get himself checked. We were also one of the first to talk to the Delhi government that to be able to take care of our employees, if we have to hire a hotel, keep people in the hotel, and provide our own doctors. Because initially there was, the sort of preparedness from the government was also, as far as the treatment and for the COVID positive people, was not really forthcoming. So we said that we will be able to manage that, and we actually got the permissions and we took care of things. So that's where people felt that, okay, here is a company which is not just asking us to work, it's also ensuring that they're going to take care of us. And we were very clear right from day one, if somebody is not able to come from his house to workplace because he is staying in a containment zone, perfectly fine, he can stay at home. He gets his salary. But if he is outside a containment zone and he can work, we will provide every possible help, whether in the form of passes or cabs or buses or staff buses. Of course, staff buses was from one bus, we had to move to something like 10 buses to be able to take care of the social distancing norms. So I guess these were some of the things the most important was motivating the people to be able to come to the workplace and deliver the goods to the consignees. So with that, thank you very much. I'll be glad to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sen. Yes, and that was very crisp and very nicely put it together. Without losing much time, I will take in Angad Rajain. Yes, there's a lot that you all have been doing. And this is your question. Having said, what have your key learnings from COVID been, and how do you perceive the future of security and facility management?
Thank you, Mona. Mona, I hope I'm audible.
Yes, very much. Thank you. Million-dollar question. Yes.
Perfect. Well, I'll try to be brief, conscious that, so we can take as many questions. As a security and FM professional, I think it's important to just take 1 second to step back and see how big the industry is. As an industry, it's very fragmented, security and FM. We have more than 15,000 service providers in the sector, and more than 10 million people get employed by this sector. I think one of the panelists mentioned that's one of the largest, one of the top 10 employers. Actually, it's one of the largest employer of people in India if you combine security, FM, and the ancillary services. So the magnitude is very large in terms of the impact and the dent it can make. One of the most important learning that I would say that we've taken away is financial stability matters. It's probably the most important thing. you know, when you are dealing with people who have to deal with health and safety, as Colonel Bana rightly mentioned, where you have to get their wages paid, whether you have to stay compliant with the government. These pillars can't be standing on their own without the stability of a strong financial balance sheet. So it matters a lot, you know, in terms of a provider to provide that comfort to your employees as well as your customers. One of the interesting things that I was trying to take away, you know, from our Prime Minister and the government's initiative is our vision of having an Atmanirbhar Bharat. Now, the Atmanirbhar Bharat, beyond, you know, not importing goods and producing our own services and goods, I think FM and security have shown us that we can be a self-contained country. We can self-sustain our organization and we can do it with our own strength. So I think that's one of the important learnings, because now security and FM professionals are given much more credibility with board members of large companies, with senior management. The CEO wants to now speak to the head of facility, the head of security, to ask him, what should we do? How do we open our office? Can we open our office? And more importantly, how will we keep our employees safe and confident about coming to the office? If I move to the other end, the industry has been, you know, quite plagued with having low tech investment. Technology is quite limited. If whatever technology we use, it's quite siloed. We'll have one app for one thing, another app for another thing, and you can see where that goes. You have 17 apps for doing 17 different things.
Sure.
But that's changing. I think that the balance is tilting towards investing in technology. Maybe it's a virtue of the crisis and the actions that are driving it. But I think that's a big move. I think the last learning that I'll mention is, I think Mr. Mangla mentioned and Colonel Bana also mentioned it, retention of people in our sector is quite difficult. Wages are low, minimum wages are prevalent across the country. 30 to 40% of the workforce gets churned every year. So what I'm trying to allude to is the knowledge owners, the people who run our facilities, who are critical to, you know, keeping e-commerce supply chain live, keeping the gen sets running, keeping our elevators running, keeping our server rooms running. These people are the knowledge banks. And I think this crisis has provided us renewed appreciation and the focus that these people have. Now, if these people are lost through this crisis and attrition, we have a bigger challenge coming our way in terms of reopening our businesses and restarting our program. Having said that, I think there's a question that a lot of people will probably ask, what's the right way of doing, my SOPs, what's the right way of doing sanitization and many more things. And what we've also got very familiar with is with the University of WhatsApp, which as much as it is a boon, it's a bane in terms of the amount of misinformation which can very quickly and inadvertently spread. So we have to be very, very careful of sifting the good from the bad and finding a subject matter expert and then asking them the right questions. So I think those were probably the key learnings that I'll mention. Now in terms of future, I won't go into minute and granular details, but one thing that Mr. Froese mentioned was contactless soap dispenser. Now you'll have to think about contactless security and contactless facility management. That's the biggest change that we'll see in terms of how security and FM is done in the future. How do you do temperature screening without a man standing there? Thermal screening cameras. How do you do attendance management without having those biometric machines, facial recognition? How do you manage a large mobile workforce through mobility solutions? We'll have to challenge ourselves to find how to run our business without or minimizing the amount of contact. Now, the second biggest learning, or I guess future that I would see, is process realignment. We'll have to literally rewrite the process with which we interact in a social environment. Be it in an office, in an Uber, in a meeting room, or even just in a coffee shop. These are all social environments that we'll need to relearn how to behave and how to act. And that cultural shift is where security and FM are going to play a very, very big role. I think Mr. Feroz mentioned it, and so did Mr. Mangla. A lot of businesses prepare emergency plans, disaster recovery plans, BCPs. But if you don't have a plan, and you know your plan, and more importantly, you test your plan, you're not going to go places. So there's a very interesting saying that I've heard from Brigadier Broy. The more you prepare in peace, the less you will bleed in war. And that's exactly what it means to testing your emergency preparedness. Finally, I'll stop and mention that sanitization will become a way of life for a foreseeable future. So we'll have to get prepared. We'll have to learn, whether it's electrostatic cleaning or smart washroom solutions, we'll have to challenge ourselves to find how do we keep a clean, sanitized environment for a foreseeable long future. Mohana, I'll stop there, but thank you very much for taking my comments here.
Thank you so much, Angad. And I should say that you almost beautifully, in your speech itself, summed up the takeaways from this particular panel discussion. Thank you so much for making my work easy. Not taking much time because I think we are running out of time as well. There are some wonderful questions and lovely fans of Asha also here who are waiting to know that when are the theatres going to open up. So this question directed to Asha Patania, since entertainment and hospitality is one of the hard hit sector due to COVID, when exactly do you foresee its revival and how will your industry norms change due to this? This question comes from Amar Agarwal, Business Development Manager, Neha Creations. Amit Yadav, Admin Manager, Max Life Insurance. Asha, on to you.
Thank you, Mohana. And thank you for the panelists for having the patience to go through our webinar and be able to involve yourself and ask these questions. So answering the first, Mohana, that we are keeping our fingers crossed that it should open sooner than later. We have been ready since April. From the time the lockdown was declared and 20 days they said, and we said 21st day we will open. So you can imagine that we have been ready since April. And every time a new information comes, a new technology gets declared, or a new WHO advisory comes, we update our processes. We just go back and we change everything and we say, now we are ready. So you will know. The day the lockdown is lifted, the multiplexes are allowed to operate, you will see us up and running in a week's time. That's the time we have given internally to ourselves. We are ready. And it would be as safe as possible, safer than any other place that you would like to be. There would be no fear. I can assure you of that. There is a task force which I am leading from the front with the help of our management. And enough is being done. Our processes, our standards, our SOPs, and our everyday learning about the subject matter, we are learning every day. You can trust us. You can have the assurance that we are ready to learn from any industry. We are seeking a lot of help from hospitals. We have got health experts guiding us. We have taken services from the leading hospitals. And people who have guided us on sanitization and the chemicals, the disinfectants, the contactless points, over 100 points have been identified, which would be cleaned at regular intervals with the checklist all displayed. So I think we would like to open in a very safe environment. A lot of technology has already been deployed, employed. And very soon you will start seeing our efforts through the digital communication. And there would be some walkthroughs that you will see. And there will be enough communication for you. And all those questions will be answered in that communication, a formal communication from the management.
Thank you so much, Asha. And yes, to underlining all this is that everything can happen. Possibly if we all are more self-disciplined and follow the rules which is laid down. And definitely the theatres will open.
Yeah.
Okay, coming to this question is for Colonel Bana. This says, what will be the ideal SOP to be followed in case any asymptomatic employee walks into the office surpassing all the checks in place? This question comes to you from Abhijit Roth, Zonal Head Admin of IIFL. Kanil Bana.
Thank you, Mona. So, you know, these situations will happen because there will be situations where we would, and it's not happened that it's not happened in corporates, it's happened across all the other segments where we've seen people have not been diagnosed or the symptoms have not been detected initially, but they've got their symptoms have come out later. So I think the government protocols are very clear on this, that as soon as we find out that this person, not only does he get into a quarantine and gets tested and gets the required medication, but it's important to do the contact tracing at this point. So I think it becomes a little more complex if it's not detected earlier. That's the reality of it. It may not happen, but then moment it is done, the most important thing that comes here is truthfulness of the employee to give what's whom he has been in contact with, and to kind of rather than create an element of fear in all the people he's been in contact with, sensitize them that it's for their good and help them come forward and get themselves tested. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Colonel Bana. Coming to the next question, this goes to Mr. Amit Mangla. The recalibration to work from home is going to highlight the need for major business adjustments. How do you plan to address it? This comes from Imran, Automotive Engineer Renault. Mr. Amit Mangala, you have to unmute yourself.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Good question, Mona. So, you know, as I started in the beginning, you know, at least I can talk about my industry, and you know, we always thought that this is an industry, and you know, which is purely touch and feel. And in initial 1 month, you know, of lockdown, Mona, we realized that this is not really the case. Today we are, you know, doing the sales volumes, which are around 70 to 80% of what we did in the similar period last year. So, you know, the whole thing, the whole business, you know, geared up to become digital very soon. Although we had invested in many of these digital technologies earlier, but we were not really equipped to go to customer digitally. Now all of that has changed. As simple thing as, you know, calling up customers on a WhatsApp video call. Things like, you know, developing applications where the customer can very easily fill the application form of an insurance policy, and just submit it, and it comes to us, you know, digitally, have been deployed, and it has been deployed across the industry. So having said that, you know, when, you know, whilst we have realized in last 3 or 4 months that not everything, you know, needs to be done coming to office, we are, you know, under, we are under consideration of, you know, working out at a company level that how do we work virtually, how do we work digitally, and it is not only about real estate, you know, cost saving, but it is also about, you know, how do you attract new talent, how do you attract millennials, okay, because, you know, there was this research done by E&Y recently which said that, you know, around 75% plus employees worldwide, and this was done, you know, with 15,000 odd people across 80 countries, which said that more than 75% of the employees today would like to have an option of flexible workplace, which means, you know, they would like a choice. They won't like to be called to office every day. Similarly, 55% of the employees said that, you know, for them, having a choice of flexible workplace will take precedence over the reputation of the company. Okay. So the post-millennials and millennials have a very different way of thinking. And, you know, as far as this question is concerned, I think, Mona, the time is now has now come where we will have specialists more instead of generalists. So, you know, somewhere, for example, in my company, you know, someone who needs to develop an application, a cutting-edge, you know, AI application, and that guy is sitting in California. Why do I need that person to come to my office? And why do I need to hire someone who has to come to office every day? When work from anywhere will become a reality, and it is, you know, coming to our industry. You know, I understand it is not there in production lines and manufacturing. It is a bit tough, but in service industry, work from anywhere is Absolutely. Going to be the new mantra.
Absolutely right. I think point taken from there, this is the changing phase. And that's what we are seeing. We're actually doing a virtual conference here. Okay, coming to the next question. This is for Angad, a quick one. By integrating technology and security services, are we not risking the job of a guard? This is from Vikas Sangwan, Express Bees.
Thank you, Mon. Great question. Whether it's whether it's contactless security or doing thermal screening, we have to understand that the job that a security guard does can't be replaced. What you'll see is that the quality and the caliber of the guard will go up, and the tasks that they will execute will change. So for example, taking an example of a cinema hall, Asha, I'm sorry for doing that. If you put a smart camera that does compliance of people wearing masks, that's fantastic. Asha will know in a cinema hall, all her staff and all the patrons who are not wearing masks. But the camera can't walk up to that patron or an employee and remind them that this is what you need to do. That's where that human element can't be substituted, if I can say. Apps are made so that people can use them, not the other way around. So that's how I would probably put out. So I don't think we need to worry about risk of losing the job of security. But yes, we will definitely see the focus on skilling and training, which means people who were doing tasks which were very redundant and very low level, those will now see a better opportunity for them.
Okay. Thank you, Angad. I'll come to, we'll take one more question. This is for Ms. Feroz. The last mile delivery has played a key role, not just in lockdown, but even now when people are skeptic of going to the local grocery and retail stores. How are you preparing your team to ensure the supply and demand disruption is not created? This is from Anuj Rajain, CEO of Soteria.
Thank you very much. I think during the midst of the COVID crisis, when a lot of the startups were actually laying off or firing staff, I think we were one of the only, one of the few companies which was actually hiring extra people and taking on people, whether it's in the different departments, whether it's technology and the others. We in fact hired so many more warehouses during the lockdown period itself, because we realized that since we are a end-to-end player in the logistics field, where it's not just omni-channel, it's also e-commerce, it's also full truckloads and things like that. And people want a good end-to-end experience, and they want a digital experience, and they want to be able to monitor it, command it, control it, which we are somehow able to do it because of the kind of automatic sorting machines which we have in about 17 centers all over India, where we can literally sort based on type of commodity, based on type of the box, based on fragility, things like that. So hence, we are sort of better prepared, and luckily, because of all these reasons, we are having more packets today than what we were doing probably even last Diwali. So that's the good part of it. We are definitely well prepared for it. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Feroz. While I know that the time is ticking, I would request Harsha to come in. And before that, I would thank all the panelists for giving such a wonderful rendition and giving a lot of takeaways. If you see the chat, they are full of, they're saying they are encouraged, and there's a lot of takeaways that they have here. Harsha, please, if you can take over from here. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you, Mona. It has been really an enlightening session and a truly wonderful webinar. Without delaying it any further, we'll just have Brigadier Oberoi sum it up for us. Over to you, sir.
So kindly unmute yourself. Yes.
Thank you, Harsha. Thank you, Mona. I'm quite sure everyone will agree with me that we had very insightful discussion in the last hour and a half or so. I am truly pleased to see that the response that we've had to this webinar has been extremely wonderful. On behalf of the Terran Group, I would like to thank all of you for joining us. The participation has been very encouraging, with pertinent questions being addressed. Our panelists have done a splendid job in addressing the core issues that we need to tackle as an industry. Their collective inputs have given us a new direction towards innovating and implementing the best practices at our own workplaces as well. I truly believe the workplace reflects the core values of a company. While we return to a new normal at offices and public places, it is now our responsibility to put safety, hygiene, and security at the forefront for both visitors and employees. Technologies like thermal screening, contactless attendance management are going to be the game changer. Over the last 3 months, we all have worked hard to identify new protocols, and I hope today's exchange of ideas will greatly help us all. Again, on behalf of the Terran Group, I express our gratitude to the panelists and the participants for making our first edition of Terran Talks such a great success. As I would like to acknowledge the efforts of our corporate communications team, who have worked hard behind the curtains to develop the concept of this webinar series, Terran Talks, and bring it to fruition. Stay tuned in to our LinkedIn handle to get the key takeaways of this webinar. And thank you, and stay safe.
Thank you, Mona. Pleasure.
Thank you to all the panelists. Thank you, Major Manjit ji, Angad, and the rest of the team, and Harsha, with your team, a lovely performance and a fantastic webinar. And thank you, the attendees, who have been wonderful listeners here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mona. Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye.